Good morning, and welcome again to Bethel Methodist Church of Robinson. Let's begin our service this morning with a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for our time together. We thank you for the opportunity to meet. We thank you, Father, for the opportunity to know that you are with us. Thank you, Lord God, that we can still share in each other's lives, that we can still be a part of your kingdom, that we can still be aware of the needs that are going on around us in our world, in our families. We thank you, Father, for the fact that you have called us to be active in your kingdom, that you have called us, Lord God, to seek you out, to search out what it means to know you, how it is, Lord God, that we can understand you, that you call us into relationship with yourself. Father, what an amazing thing that is. What a joy, what a privilege it is to know you and to walk with you. We pray, Father, that as we go through this morning, as we sing these songs together, as we read the scriptures together, as the message is preached, we ask, Father, for your blessing upon all of this. Because, Lord, it's you that we seek to glorify, not ourselves. And we thank you again, Father, for the opportunity this morning to join together, even if it's in this way. Hear us now as we join our hearts and our voices together, praying as Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Psalm 116, thanksgiving for deliverance from death. I love the Lord because he has heard my voice and my supplications, because he has inclined his ear to me. Therefore, I will call upon him as long as I live. The pains of death surround me, and the pangs of Sheol laid hold of me. I found trouble and sorrow. Then I called upon the name of the Lord. O Lord, I implore you, deliver my soul. What shall I render to the Lord for all his benefits toward me? I will take up the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. He will pay my vows to the Lord, now in the presence of all his people. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. O Lord, truly I am your servant. I am your servant, the son of your maidservant. You have loosed my bonds. I will offer to you the sacrifice of thanksgiving, and will call upon the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord, now in the presence of all his people, in the courts of the Lord's house, in the midst of you, O Jerusalem. Praise the Lord. Psalm 100. Make a joyful shout to the Lord, all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful to him and bless his name.
Now behold, two of them were traveling that same day to a village called Emmaus, which was 7 miles from Jerusalem. And they talked together of all these things which had happened. So it was, while they conversed and reasoned, that Jesus himself drew near and went with them. But their eyes were restrained, so that they did not know him. And he said to them, "What kind of conversation is this that you have with one another as you walk and are sad?" Then one whose name was Cleopas answered and said to him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem? And have you not known the things which happened here in these days?" And he said to them, "What things?" So they said to him, "The things concerning Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we were hoping that it was he who was going to redeem Israel. Indeed, besides all this, today is the third day since these things happened. Yes, and certain women of our company who arrived at the tomb early astonished us. When they did not find his body, they came saying that they all had also seen a vision of angels who had said he was alive. And certain of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see. Then he said to them, 'Oh, foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe in all that the prophets had spoken. Ought not the Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory?' And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. And they drew near to the village where they were going, and he indicated that he would have gone farther. But they constrained him, saying, 'Abide with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is far spent.' And he went in to stay with them. Now it came to pass, as he sat at the table with them, that he took the bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they knew him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to one another, 'Did not our heart burn within us while he talked with us on the road and while he opened the scriptures to us?' So they rose up that very hour and returned to Jerusalem and found the 11 and those who were with them gathered, saying, 'The Lord is risen indeed and has appeared to Simon.' And they told about the things that had happened on the road and how he was known to them in the breaking of the bread."
Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is sitting at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. And from there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the one universal church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you.
continue this morning on our journey toward Pentecost. There were a few verses in the scripture reading this morning from Luke that I wanted to draw your attention to before we jump into our sermon this morning. That's going to start in Numbers chapter 21. But listen again to just a few of these verses from Luke's gospel. First of all, we have what Cleopas is saying to this stranger who was walking along with him. We know it was Jesus, but at the time, Cleopas was unaware of this. Verse 21, Cleopas says, "But we were hoping that it was he who was going to redeem Israel. Indeed, besides all this, today is the third day since these things have happened." I love this verse because it reminds us of the mental anguish. It reminds us of the grief and the state of hopelessness that these disciples found themselves in. But then I also love the fact that the stranger, Jesus, does something for this group of disciples, something that we are doing. We are intentionally, as Jesus' disciples, walking along the same path. Listen to what it is that Jesus does for these folks. Starting in verse 27, "And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself." I know at various times throughout my short lifetime, there have been those voices from the Christian world who have said, why do we need to hold on to the Old Testament? Why don't we just be done with it, cut ourselves loose from it? And there, all the cultural references and all of the things that are going on in the Old Testament that we have a hard time with, let's just do away with those things. I love the fact that these are the scriptures that Jesus went back to tell his disciples about God's plan, in which Jesus had a huge part here, in which Jesus was the central part. And then after the breaking of bread together, and after the stranger was revealed to be Jesus, listen again to what these disciples, listen to the change of their attitude here. "And they said to one another, did not our heart burn within us while he talked with us on the road and while he opened scriptures to us?" This morning, as we turn to these passages from the Old Testament and one from the New Testament, may God burn within our heart. May the Holy Spirit make alive what we find here, helping us to realize that he's revealing to us exactly who he is and exactly what he's doing, so that we can join with him and be a part of what's going on as well. As we journey toward Pentecost over these next 7 weeks, we are searching through the scriptures. We find ourselves this morning in Numbers 21, and it's easy to avoid reading this book at times. The first third or so of Numbers starts off, and it's just a genealogy, it seems like. Just one group of people after another. These are the folks who made up this tribe. These are the folks that made up this tribe. And it's tough to get through that. And once you do get through that, then you get to the last two-thirds of the book, and it's like a bad travel brochure almost about where not to go if you're ever traveling in the Holy Land. But the reality is that God has a tendency to hide some amazing truths about himself and some fantastic information. It's stuck in those events, stuck in those things that it's so easy for us to look over. No, this is not the traditional type of passage that we would go to if we wanted to feel good about ourselves or to make ourselves comfortable. This is the type of passage that reveals some things that perhaps are true about us, just as they were true about the ancient Hebrew people here. We are going to be reading a strange little story. A strange little story that's stuck between two accounts of where the Hebrew people are going on their journey from the land of Egypt to the land of Canaan, from bondage and slavery in Egypt to freedom in Canaan. And we find this strange little story, a strange little story that involves complaining, snakes, and healing. Let's start reading in verse 4. "Then they," that is the Hebrew people, "journeyed from Mount Hor by the way of the Red Sea to go around the land of Edom. And the soul of the people became very discouraged on the way. And the people spoke against God and against Moses. Why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there is no food and no water, and our soul loathes this worthless bread. So the Lord sent fiery serpents among the people, and they bit the people, and many of the people of Israel died. Therefore the people came to Moses and said, "We have sinned, for we have spoken against the Lord and against you. Pray to the Lord that he take the serpents away from us." So Moses prayed for the people. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Make a fiery serpent, set it on a pole, and it shall be that everyone who is bitten, when he looks at it, shall live." So Moses made a bronze serpent and put it on a pole. And so it was, if a serpent had bitten anyone, when he looked at the bronze serpent, he lived. I told you, it was an odd story. As it stands here in Numbers chapter 21, there doesn't seem to be that much deep theological insight into this story. Where do we find Jesus in this story about complaining and snakes and healing? The people continue their long exodus. Already this journey has been increased because of the many times the people complained and rebelled against Moses' leadership and God's leadership. And now, in addition to the hardship of the journey, they get right up to the land of Edom. These are their cousins. These are Esau's descendants. We can find the rest of that story over in Genesis chapter 32 of Esau being the father of the Edomites. But instead of being welcomed by their cousins, they are pushed away. They are repulsed. They're told that they have no right to be here. We don't want you in our land. We don't want you coming across this way. We will not open our borders to let you come across, to take a shortcut right across to where you need to go. And so the people had to take the long way around. They took the journey all the way around Edom, and that's really what we find throughout the rest of this chapter. And that's one of the things that's happening here as they're journeying. All of these delays and this huge detour now brings about frustration in the minds of the Hebrew people. And the people start to criticize Moses, and they blame God for the situation they find themselves in. To quiet the complaining and to correct their sinful attitude of rebellion, God sends snakes to torment the people. Snakes are not unusual in this part of the world, but there was something about these snakes that got embedded in the memory of the Hebrew people. The word that we have translated as fiery in our passage that we read from has also been translated in other Bibles as poisonous. But the word can also refer to the color of the snakes, not just the intensity of their bite, but the color, that how they looked. They looked like they were fiery. The idea here, though, is not what it felt like when the snakes bit you. It's not what the snakes looked like when you saw them. To get hung up on the color or how painful the bite was misses the point of what's really going on in this passage. You see, the fact is the people had no way of dealing with these serpents. God did what God does when the people cried out to him, and God intervened to provide the way of healing that the Hebrew people needed, the way of healing that they could not provide for themselves. Even though the story of the bronze snake in Numbers is odd but still kind of interesting, it might have been forgotten about except for a reference found in 2 Kings 18:4. One little verse. The story is of Hezekiah, a king who is followed after the king Asa. And Hezekiah is bringing about some great spiritual reforms in the nation of Judah. And as he brings about these reforms, we're told in one little verse, in 2 Kings 18:4, we are told, "He removed the high places and broke the sacred pillars, cut down the wooden image, and broke in pieces the bronze serpent that Moses had made. For until those days, the children of Israel burned incense to it and called it Nehushtan." This refers to King Hezekiah, as I said. And as he's going about this program of reform, he comes into the temple and he finds this image from Israel's history. Someone had held on to this. I mean, here's the image that God had had Moses make, the image that was supposed to be hung on a pole in order to bring healing to the nation. Instead, someone decided, hey, that's the thing that we need to hang up and pray to and offer incense to so that it can bring healing for us as well. You see how easily something that God gives can be twisted into an idol? That's exactly what had happened here. The burning of incense to something is a way of talking about praying to an object. And that's what was going on. As the smoke from the incense rises up to heaven, the idea is that your prayers rise along with it to the place where this divine being resides. Now, Moses never constructed the bronze serpent as an object of worship. It's important for us to understand. God did not tell Moses to go make an idol for my people to pray to. Not at all. That was never the intent. But over time, over the years, that's what happened. That subtle twist, that way that sin always seems to work, and taking something that God gives as a way for us to look up to him, and instead twisting it into something that causes us once again to look back into ourselves. What happened, you might be asking? What happened over the course of time that would cause the people to forget the reason that the image was given and instead turn it into an idol? Well, the purpose of any idol is an attempt to control God in order to accomplish our will over God's will. Why do people turn to idols? Because having an idol gives people a sense of power and a sense of control over their own lives. Anything can be twisted into idolatrous usage. It seems like this way of thinking even affected the Ark of the Covenant at some points in Israel's history. And apparently, this figure, this bronze serpent that Moses had made, the symbol of suffering, reminded the people not of God's healing power, but reminded the people instead to pray to this thing. They had turned it into an idol. Even in our day and age, there are those people out there who treat the cross of Jesus or the elements of communion or even the act of baptism in an idolatrous way, giving the symbol the same power to redeem, protect, or save that only God has. Once again, we might not ever have heard this story from ancient Israel, from Hezekiah's reforms, had it not been for Jesus making reference to this event in his conversation with Nicodemus. We find that in John chapter 3, and it starts in verse 14. Jesus speaks and he says, "And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life." The purpose of the serpent on the pole in the wilderness was not to form an idol for the people to worship, but to have the people look up to God to find healing instead of looking to themselves. When Jesus speaks of the serpent being lifted up, he has the same idea in mind. Look to God to find healing. The context of this passage here in John chapter 3 makes it very clear that the healing that Jesus has in mind is the healing of all people from sin. That's why the very next verse, John 3:16, is the summary of God's good news. We find in John 3:16 that salvation originates in the love of God for a fallen and an unbelieving world. That salvation centers in the giving of God's only Son to redeem the world. That salvation is completed with the offer that all people may not be lost, but instead choose to live in a saving relationship with God. The eternal life that God extends through Jesus is the life of being brought into God's kingdom. And this new life starts the moment that God's redemption is received. It's not just eternal life about somewhere out there at some time in the future after I'm dead and gone. It's about knowing God's life, being infused with God's life here, now, in this life. That's the offer that God is making to us. That's the exchange. Give up your self-centered life and receive instead the life that I give you, the abundant life, the full life that can come only from knowing and walking with and being in relationship with God. Jesus' work on the cross provides the way of healing in this life, right here, right now, the way of healing from sins and from sin, and gives us also the victory over sinning. It is through Jesus that we are set free to be in relationship with God, and it is in relationship with God where He, God, is making us holy. Just like last week, as the disciples read through the scriptures that we know as the Old Testament, they found God's work of salvation. And again, God's work is wrapped up in Jesus. As we read through these verses, we find that the work of salvation applies to the need for redemption and salvation that we have today. As we stand before God, we recognize the emptiness of our own life, and we can feel the sting of guilt from sins in our past. We see our need to be set on the right path. We see our need to be kept on the right path. We see our need to look to God daily for His grace and His power. We see our need for God's eternal life to fill our life. We recognize our need to look up, to look away from ourselves. And when we look up to God, we see Jesus. And we find in Jesus the answer to our greatest need, and that's for spiritual healing. We find in Jesus the one who was lifted up in crucifixion and lifted up to the right hand of God in glorification, every hope that we could ever have satisfied. Normally, this would be the day that we would be taking communion together. It's the last Sunday of the month. We have in front of me here the representation of communion. We have the bread, we have the cup. And we see in those elements not an idolatrous image to worship, not a way of thinking that it's through those elements that we are made right with God. But we see that what's represented there is the body, the life, and the death of Jesus. We see both of those things, and we are reminded again, even through something as simple as what we eat and something to drink, that God's life is extended and offered out to all who will receive, to whosoever will believe. What an amazing God who can remind us through the most simple of means of the most incredible love and of the greatest offer that the world has ever been made. Let us sing our final hymn together this morning. Thank you. have some announcements to share this morning. First of all, I know that tomorrow, on April 27th, will come the announcement from the governor. Apparently, he's supposed to cover some of the things about when we will be able to meet again together. We are optimistic, we are hopeful that we will be meeting here at the church again very soon. Stay tuned this week. It'll be through an email or through a phone call that the information will come out whether or not we'll be able to meet together in our sanctuary next Sunday. For the time being, all planned activities have been canceled or postponed until after May the 4th. Interchurch Council is still looking at and trying to figure out a plan for a virtual meeting so that they can discuss the timing for general conference, when that will be held, how that will be held. Again, this next weekend was the proposed date for that. We'll see what kind of announcement, what kind of information comes out, and we'll include that to you again in this coming week. Next weekend was supposed to have been general conference. Continue to pray for our denomination. Continue to pray for each of the Bethel Methodist churches, wherever they might be. Not just our Bethel Methodist church here, but the ones all over, from Port Neches to North Texas to the Hill Country up to Denton County, and of course here in Robinson as well. Pray for the ministry of each of those churches in the community in which God has planted them. Pray also for the ministry of the entire denomination together, as we have the opportunity to minister far beyond the borders of our local communities and the walls of our local churches. I do invite you again to continue to pay attention to what's going on the website. It's bethelmethodist.com/Robinson. Register for Faith Life Group there at faithlife.com/Bethel Methodist. And remember also about online giving. I want to thank you all so much. Y'all are doing such a great job. Our giving has remained very steady. I appreciate your faithfulness. I appreciate the way that God has laid it upon your heart to continue giving to the ministry here of the Bethel Methodist Church of Robinson. Thank you so much for responding to the call that God has placed upon you to continue to give to our local church. Once again, as we finish up this time together, we are reminded of just the joy of being able to be with one another, and the longing that we have, each of us has, of hoping to see one another again. We look forward to that time. We pray that it will be soon, very soon, that we will be able to meet together again. Until that time, may God be with you. Let's sing that chorus together. God, truly our desire is to meet again together, to see one another, to be able to catch up on each other's lives, to be able to shake hands, to be able to give hugs, to be able to do all of those things that we love to do as we see our brothers and sisters in Christ. Until that time, Father, we're thankful for the fact that you unite us with the bond of love through faith in you, through the presence of your Holy Spirit active and at work in us. Father, you instruct us. You tell us about who you are. You give us understanding that we might know you, so that we can live in relationship with you, so that, Father, we can be useful tools in your hand as you send us out into this world. And now, Father, you do send us out. And I remember that blessing that the priests used to pray over the people in Israel, that your face, Lord God, would shine upon us, that you, Lord God, would support us and lift us up, and that you, Lord God, would give us the strength that we need every single day to be your people. Thank you, Father, for your presence with us. Thank you, Father, that as you send us out, you give us all that we need in Christ Jesus.